one would find was that very well-intentioned, very well-designed programs, policies would get created. But, and people would be working very hard, putting in all the efforts, getting all the best people together, you know, trying to make collaborations, everything. At the national level, then at the state level. But the more you go down to districts, you go down to schools, you sit on the floor of a school, you see what is going on in the class, you find that those things are not translating into the school. And this is the reality of the country. Somehow those things are not translating in the schools the way they should be. It's not that nothing is happening. I'm not at all saying that nothing is happening, but what is envisioned is not really reaching the schools, and where the disruptions are taking place, what is happening between center and state and district block, and then block and school, is something, what is happening in this entire system, is something that we all have to reflect upon wherever we are working, because there are so many CSR people sitting here, and we are all working in our little or larger spaces. But this is something that we have to really understand and make sense of, that where are these disruptions happening, why are they happening, and what can we do about them? That is one point that I wanted to make to start with. The second thing is that I have worked with different categories of children, out of school children, different categories, sometimes very, very challenging. And if I just skip to what we are doing at the moment, and I can go back from there. I'm working with Tata Steel CSR, and education is our priority sector. And what we are trying to do, when we designed the program, we had a lot of deliberation on what is it that we should really be doing. How can we make doing our small thing, how can we really do it in such a way that it can become, at least provide some learnings to the states at large where we are working, and even to the states, the larger country as such. So after a lot of deliberation, we decided on combining several aspects of education. And Mr. Ramanan was talking about the SDGs, and the education SDG says to begin with that ensure inclusive and quality education for all. Inclusive and quality education for all. So what we have tried to do is, we have tried to, so while we say that there's enrollment, and we have almost cleared the issue of enrollment, but when you go to the schools, you find that children are not in the schools. Their roles, names may be on the school rolls, but the children are not in the school. Very high degree of absenteeism, very high degree of teacher absenteeism or teacher unavailability, and hence children absenteeism. Children are enrolled, parents have made all efforts to, you know, put their children in school, but when they don't get anything out of school, when a child comes back to school after a 15-day gap and finds that she has not lost anything, nothing much happened in those 15 days, it's giving a very strong message to the child and to the family that you may as well sit at home and do some work. So the thing is that, again, we have at the policy level, one thing is happening, at the ground level, something else is happening. So what we have tried to do is, again, I refer to the SDG and then referring to the Right to Education Act. We are all talking of the same thing, inclusive and quality education. So we are working on three aspects of education. One is access. And access we define as every child in school, eliminating child labor, and not only that, to ensure that they come to school on a regular basis. What can we do to ensure that children come to school on a regular basis? So one is access. The second is learning. And the third is governance. Governance is, again, we were talking about the school management committees, the communities, and so on and so forth. So I will elaborate on these a little bit more in the next few minutes. But we decided that if we can, so there are many organizations in the country that have done brilliant work on access. MB Foundation in Hyderabad is one of the pioneers in the country that have done tremendous work on eliminating child labor and ensuring children are in school. And they've developed strategies like bridging and so on and so forth. So it's not that we have evolved that strategy. We have taken it from MV Foundation. But the second thing that we've added to it is quality of learning. Because if you keep putting children in school and the school is not giving them anything, they keep dropping out. So the second thing that we have linked to the goal, to the aspect of access, is learning. And if we speak about learning, the big challenge in the country, and you know, ASSA report is coming year after year, many other studies have been done on learning, and everyone says the same thing: children cannot read, they cannot write, they can't do basic numbers. This is what we've been hearing for the last 5 years at least. Now, when we were just discussing about half an hour back, and we were talking of the challenge inside the school, of the teachers being trained to teach, say, grade one language, but when they are in the school, they find a single teacher has to deal with all the classes. So the training is of one kind and the challenge in the school is of another kind. So what do we see? I mean, rarely do you have grade-wise or subject-wise teachers. But what do the teachers do when they reach the school after that training? By and large, you find that grades 1 and 2 are completely neglected. Teachers start focusing on grades 3, 4, and 5. School after school, state after state, by and large, this is the reality. Grades 1 and 2 are not being taught. So when they are not being taught, what the curricular requirements of grades 1 and 2 is basically reading, writing, and mathematics. They are not taught. They are not enabled in those competencies. So when they go to higher classes, they are not able to read and write. So what will you teach them? A class 3 teacher will say with great frustration, shall I teach for grade 1 and 2 or shall I teach for what I am supposed to teach? So this is the other big reality. I don't know if this matches with your experience, but this is the experience of a lot of us who've been struggling with education for a long time. So when we created our program around learning in Tata Steel, we decided the first thing that we will do is address this learning deficit. We've created a program. It's a short 20-week program, which is beyond school hours, where we are only focusing on this learning deficit that has been created by the way the schools are functioning. And we feel that once this learning deficit is met with and children can actually read and write with fluency and comprehension and do their basic numbers, they will be able to connect with the grade level content in whichever class they are. So I'm just talking in very brief. So we are working on learning, access learning, and the third is governance. So the governance vertical is, again, let's go back to a village. Most of the parents are either illiterate or semi-literate. There is no home support. If you look at a family like any of our families, the amount of time that a parent spends with a child on a daily basis, 2 to 3 hours every evening, is what establishes what is being done in the classroom. Minus that, some of senior people have said that even a DPS will produce illiterate kids. Just think about it. The sheer value and volume of home support that children get, which is completely lacking in rural schools. So, and it's lacking because, you know, we have families, maybe a second or a third generation. You don't find this in Kerala because you have third generation families, educated families. So you don't find that issue. But in a large tracts of the country, this is really the issue. So, and the communities don't feel that they can engage with the school because they feel, I can't read, I can't write. What say do I have in the matter? So what the communities do is they watch helplessly from a distance a school that is not performing. Their child comes back not able to even have the basics in place, even after spending 3 or 4 or 5 years in the school. So, but still, we are talking of the third vertical as governance, and RTE, the Right to Education Act, has given us a great enabler in the form of a school management committee. Now, the school management committee, we all know, is constituted in a very sensible way, with 75% of the members as parents of children who are in school. So, but again, when you see the status of the school management committees, most members do not even know that they are members. forget about knowing their roles and responsibilities or actually taking action on the ground. So what we are trying to do is we are working to train the school management committees and then to handhold them over a period of time, over several months, of how to understand a school as an entity. What is actually child labor? What is right to education? Training them on all these things at length. Then they go back, we help them to start running monthly meetings. How to set an agenda for a monthly meeting? What are the aspects that they can start looking at? What is, and when they list down the aspects of education in a village, how do they prioritize? How do they start taking action? How do they start governing the school? Can the parents, can the SMC members be present in the school at least 2 to 3 times every week? The moment these things start happening on the ground, you start seeing a lot of things changing in the school. Very simple things. Schools start opening on time. They start closing on time. Midday meal starts to improve. Assemblies which never took place in the school start to get organized. Then the parents start to go to those homes, identify those mohallas, those homes from which children are not coming or are highly irregular, and they start interacting with the parents. They start convincing them that, you know, please send your child to school. Lots of things start happening. At a further stage, they start growing vegetable gardens, they start organizing sports, and you see that the whole village is coming together. We've also started creating youth groups, we started creating women's groups, self-help groups, so that making gradually education the agenda of the entire village. And last and most important is the panchayats. So we are getting the entire communities to start having a stake in that school in the village. So we have access, learning and governance. When we are working on these three verticals, we have managed to get 9,000 children who are out of school into schools. Now this is an issue, we're talking about government linkages. This is an issue where we start having friction with the government. Because the government sometimes does not want to acknowledge that there are children out of school. And surely they are not, because their names are in the school rolls. But they're not attending school. And they're engaged in labor, they're engaged in working on a construction site or working in a dhaba, their name is in the school, but they're not coming to school. So anyway, the idea is not to get into an argument over this. The idea is that let us try and get these children into school, if either directly or through a bridging program, short-term bridging for short dropouts, long-term bridging for 7, 8, 10-year-old dropouts, residential bridging, and gradually get these children back into school. And after that, tracking. We discussed a lot about tracking. Putting a child in school, the child may drop out again tomorrow morning. So how do we track? How do we create village education registers? A village education register, which we started doing, I think, 2 years after the program had matured, where now the communities have a track of every child from birth till 18 years of age. Every detail about every child in that village and aggregating to the panchayat is in the village or the panchayat education register. So now if you go to any of the villages, they will have data for every child. There is no chance that a child will be missed or will fall through the cracks. So this way we are gradually finding that communities are really rallying around the school. And the learning program that we run, which I mentioned, was beyond school hours, a 2-hour daily program beyond school hours, through which we are not only teaching, we are basing ourselves on the state curriculum, but we have brought a lot of teaching strategies and teaching methods from many countries, because one of my personal grouses is that we are not doing enough research on learning in this country. Very few universities have departments of education, and those that have are not really integrating the tremendous amount of research that has taken place in the Western countries. So over the last several years, we've been trying to get these strategies, understand them, adapt them to a rural Orissa or a rural Jharkhand or a Maharashtra or a Kutch situation. So that, and you know, with these new ways of learning, with these new strategies, we've taken stuff from Australia, from Singapore, this, that, and the other. And you find there's an explosion of learning that takes place. In just 2 short months, you see children are reading, writing, confidence is building up, they're coming to school regularly, and enriching the schools with library books, with various other things, so that schools don't remain under-resourced, just 4 blank walls. So this is the, we are seeing the results of this. We have reached out to almost 30,000 children through this already in the last 2 years. And the third thing is SMCs. So this program that I'm talking about, that which is the flagship program of Tata Steel, is called the 1000 Schools Project. And this is the last point that I want to make, is that we are marrying these three verticals of access, learning, and governance, and trying to do it at scale. So we're trying to work with government schools, no schools set up by us. We are trying to revitalize 1,000 government schools, saturating 6 blocks. So saturating, I mean, outside of Kerala today, there is not a single block in this country which can claim that every child is in school and learning and completing class 10. Is there a single block in this country? I mean, this is how sad the situation is today, despite all the fantastic stuff that we are actually planning. So we decided to stick our neck out and say, or set ourselves this goal, that in a period of say 5 or 6 years, can we really make 6 remote tribal blocks in Orissa, where we have our business operations, completely child labor free, with every child in school attending regularly, with basics of learning in place, and very strong presence of communities around these schools, so that the program becomes sustainable. So basically, I think I've run out of time. So I will close with this. We are, as the program is maturing, we are adding new things to the program. We want children to learn English. We want to bring in technology and tablets. We want to work with 21st century skills, science, so on and so forth. Let's see. Any of you that part of the country are most welcome to visit the program and have longer discussions. Thanks very much.